My name is Danny Bega, and I'm Associate Professor of Neurology here at Northwestern Medicine. I'm also the Director of the Huntington's Disease Center at Northwestern, which is an HDSA Center of Excellence. We've learned a lot about Huntington's disease in the last few years. There have been a lot of interesting observational trials in Huntington's, one of which discovered some genes that are outside of the Huntington disease gene that can affect whether the disease has its onset earlier or later. And so these are potential targets for future therapies outside of the already known Huntington disease gene. We're lucky to have observational studies that include over 25,000 people with Huntington's now. And those studies we've learned of markers of the disease progression, both imaging markers as well as markers in the spinal fluid that correspond with disease progression and disease severity, that can be future ways that we can measure changes in the disease with effective therapies that may come along. A lot of the recent trials in Huntington's have been focused on slowing down the production or stopping the production of the mutated Huntington protein, whether that's at the level of the DNA or the RNA or the protein itself. We think that that protein, the Huntington protein, when it's mutated, leads to the pathology in the disease. And so the goal is to prevent the production of that protein or get rid of that protein. Some of the trials that happened over the last few years involved antisense oligonucleotides. Those are proteins that are delivered into the spinal fluid that bind to the RNA and prevent it from making the protein. Unfortunately, there have been some disappointments with some of those trials not being effective. Although some of them continue today, there are also trials that are continuing today that deliver a viral vector directly into the brain, directly into the striatum, to slow down the production of the Huntington protein in the area that we know is where it's most produced and problematic. And so those are still early trials that are going on in people with Huntington's today. Another group of trials that are really interesting in Huntington's are splicing modulators. So these are oral medications that are being studied to introduce premature stop codons in the RNA so that when the message is read to produce the Huntington protein, it actually inserts a stop in that message to prevent the protein from being made. These are, again, still early phase one and two trials primarily. The ASO, the antisense oligonucleotide trials, were phase three trials, but more is still coming in this field, but a lot of it is focused on slowing down the Huntington protein production. One of the areas that we've been really most successful so far in Huntington's is symptom treatment for the most common symptom, which is chorea. So there are now two FDA-approved drugs to manage the chorea in Huntington's disease, which is the abnormal hyperkinetic movements that people get. And so we actually have tools in our toolbox to manage that today. And there's actually a third drug that they just released top-line data of a phase three trial. And so it's likely that a third drug will soon become available to manage the chorea in Huntington's disease. Huntington's disease is a family disease, unfortunately, and that means that when we're testing someone or suspecting Huntington's disease, it's really important to provide good genetic counseling. That means counseling for the person thinking about testing. That means counseling for the implications for other family members as well. The good news is that also may mean counseling about family planning and options for having children that may not have Huntington's disease through tools like IVF. But it's really important that counseling happens. I think that it's very important to suspect Huntington's disease anytime you have someone who has an abnormal movement disorder and a cognitive disorder, especially if there's a family history of some movement disorder. That should be one of the first things you think about in terms of testing. It's also really important that people know that we can actually do a lot today to improve quality of life for people with Huntington's disease. And so while we don't yet have a treatment for the disease itself, we do have a lot of tools to manage the motor symptoms, the mood symptoms, and other aspects of life. We have social workers who can help manage disability. We have, I mentioned, genetic counselors that can help with counseling and family planning. We have rehab members who can deal with physical and occupational and speech therapy. And so we really approach it in a multidisciplinary way. And I think it's very important that patients with Huntington's or who are at risk for Huntington's get tapped into a team approach with a multidisciplinary care team.